1 year ago, I said that 2019 could be an active year for tornadoes in the US. And I said the High Plains especially would see a more active year than we saw in 2018. And I was kind of right.
A quick review for some of you, or some context if this is the first time you've found this channel.
The winter of 2018 saw severe drought on the plains, and a less favorable for storm chasing La Nina pattern that so helped me sent tornado counts right straight down to the ground.
The winter of 2019 saw big improvements in drought conditions and a more favorable, neutral to weak El Nino. Forecasting a tornado season based on a few background states and analogs from past years isn't at all a perfect science, but suffering from SDS, or Supercell Deprivation Syndrome, may lead some storm chasers around the world to start looking for any shred of hope that a good season is just around the corner. If that's you, a warm welcome.
Now, you won't generally see professional forecasters try to make specific claims like tornado counts or specific regions of the country that might be more active than others.
But hey, at least I show my work. So this exercise is purely academic and for fun, and I love to share the good or bad news, depending on where you are and what you will take away from this information. Even in the short term, forecasting tornadoes is difficult. However, predicting their precursors, supercell thunderstorms, isn't as hard, nor is predicting many days in advance the overall weather patterns that can lead to supercell thunderstorms. There are background states, however, that can loosely predict where this activity is more likely to happen or affect the total intensity expected in a given spring. For example, 2018 not only saw very low tornado counts, but the High Plains, west of Interstate 35, were especially quiet. There were two possible explanations for this. The overall jet stream pattern in the early spring was too far south, while in the late spring, these patterns were too far north. This made the core tornado season very short. If the jet stream doesn't dive down over the Rockies of Colorado and New Mexico very often, that's going to limit tornado potential over the central plains. We can blame La Nina for this. There was a second problem. Severe drought across West Texas was leading to a very strong elevated mix layer, or EML. This is a layer of hot, dry air that serves as a cap, limiting thunderstorm development. In 2018, the EML was hotter and drier than typical, partly because of this drought. The few systems that we did happen to get were shut down by extreme capping. Still, it's possible to have a year like 2013, where in spite of these same background states, a sub-seasonal variation or two can come along and still make for a photogenic tornado year, albeit a short but intense 2 weeks with not much else going on. While 2008, by contrast, was a La Nina year with little drought, and it was a banner year for tornado chasing and high tornado counts. Lots of factors are just too unpredictable 2 to 3 months in advance. For 2019, these background states changed in a dramatic way compared to 2018. The South Texas drought was gone, and a weak El Nino pattern served up a stronger, more troughy jet stream that favored storm tracks over the southern Rockies. And while that isn't everything we need for an active year, it's a good start. More specifically, we can see features like the dry line move further west and bring severe weather and beneficial rain over America's breadbasket on the High Plains.
I remember how 2019 got started. So much promise. Multiple storm systems came in early and often,
including a deluge that fell on frozen ground over Nebraska early in the season. Additional systems came along and followed similar paths. These very strong, early systems could have meant chances for tornadoes in Oklahoma, Kansas, and Nebraska, but thanks to weak moisture return, these tornado threats didn't materialize, which really would have made a bad situation even more miserable. The Missouri River became overwhelmed, and even some sections of Interstate 29 in Iowa and Missouri would be closed from March all the way until October of 2019. In spite of this, 2019 ended up being a very active year for tornado counts, right into the 70th percentile compared to average, thanks in part to a very timely series of events that began in early May. Watch this video if you'd like to see how the weather community and computer models did, predicting that event several weeks in advance.
It's just that when I start to think about synoptic scale weather, thermodynamics, and kinematics, I lose all track of time. I could go on for hours, but I'd probably really start to bore you.
Michael, what do you make of this?
Oh, this? I can make an airplane, a little hat, or how about a little bird?
Currently, we are yet again in an ENSO neutral condition like last winter, La Nada, neither El Nino nor La Nina. However, unlike 2019, it's expected that we will stay this way through the spring rather than transition to an El Nino. ENSO neutral seems to favor western Kansas and Colorado even more than El Nino does, while other areas of the country might see numbers closer to average. But that's not the only thing we should be looking at. As for drought, this area of West Texas, Chihuahua, and the High Plains of New Mexico and Colorado are the major EML source regions. It's not terribly dry, and even then it's expected to improve some. The EML should be about average this spring. 2019 started things off a bit on the wetter side, and those early season systems obliterated what little dry soil there was in the Southwest and High Plains. Hey Michael, would you like me to take a look at the weather?
No, why don't you take care of it?
Real quick, I need to plug Brett's Sky in Motion website. Last year I spent hours and hours building out this historical storm chasing quality data in an Excel spreadsheet, and made graphs, and then later someone pointed out that something similar was already done before, and way better.
Looks like I picked the wrong week to quit smoking.
The cool thing is our data outputs looked almost identical, so I'm glad that these two systems agree. But from now on, I'm using this data alongside mine. I'll link to Brett's site in the description and refer to these charts for some of my analysis. Now here are my favorite analog years with similar ENSO and drought conditions. Interestingly, a truly neutral ENSO chase season without major drought conditions in the Southwest hasn't really happened much for a couple decades. The last 20 years have been full of moderate and severe drought. One thing you'll notice in this forecast is that things are not dramatically different from this time last year. And so this year's forecast and these analogs are going to share a few similarities. Of them, 2005 and 2007 stand out as clean analogs. What was 2007 like again? Well, it seriously saw some action with the Greensburg EF5, but the season was mostly confined to the last week in April and the first week in May. That said, many of these tornadoes were way out west in photogenic areas of the plains. March of 2007 saw a major outbreak at the end of the month, again way into the western part of the plains. June, however, was very quiet compared to average, but there were some hot spots in Iowa and Wisconsin. So let's go further back. 1993 was a neutral ENSO year, with very little in the way of southwestern drought. March and April did see some activity further west, but there weren't very many tornadoes. May was most active in the central and high plains, but again, counts were a bit on the low side overall. Things woke up like crazy in early June with several outbreaks across the central and northern plains. 1993 is perhaps more well known for the Great Flood. That's not good news. 2019 already caused a great deal of harm of this type. But guess what's popping up again?
Out of here! Look behind every tunnel! It's a twister! It's a twister!
1990 and 1991. Yep, we're doing this again. 1990 saw major systems leading to historic tornado outbreaks several times during the spring, one of which was a rare major Central Plains March outbreak. 1990 overall was a big, big year, and a lot of that activity centered on Kansas and Nebraska. 1991, however, is the iconic storm chasing year.
The boss, head year, big cheese, head honcho.
1991 had many big plains events, early and often. Four analog years, and we see each time early activity, a high ceiling for potential, and a lot of affinity toward the high plains along and west of Interstate 35. I found some more decent analogs that I liked from the more distant past. 1952, 61, 70, 79, and 82. The least active tornado year of that bunch is 1952.
Looks like I picked the wrong week to quit amphetamines.
Save for 1982, the patterns during this time were not great for tornadoes. Good news if you aren't a fan of bad weather, but I can say in all of these other examples, early season storms were still the rule. These looser analogs still hold some amount of good days along and west of I-35. So I decided to look for something else to correlate. I'd really like to know why such a difference between the last 30 years and the 30 years before it. It turns out one reason might be a strongly positive Arctic oscillation in winter, which seems to correlate, overall, pretty well with better years for storm chasing. In fact, most of my recent analogs, 2007, 90, 91, and 93, all had strongly positive Arctic oscillation through much of the previous winter. What is the Arctic oscillation? This is one of the alphabet spaghettio seasonal climate indicators observed around the world. Specifically, a positive AO is associated with a smooth jet stream across the northern hemisphere and a strong polar vortex over the Arctic where it belongs. As it turns out, we are in a long stretch of strongly positive AO this winter, as I'm saying this. So I'm leaning toward a more favorable scenario, then less so for tornadoes. Something more like what we've seen in the past 30 years rather than the previous 30. Or at least, that's what storm chasers can hope for. Now, I don't like to put a lot of stock in these other oscillations in the long range. These signals can be relatively short-lived, and in my personal opinion, don't do a great job of predicting what the next season will be like very consistently. But some people really like teleconnections. And if you are a fan of these, I have interesting news there as well. NAO has been strongly positive this winter and is forecast to stay roughly positive for now. This corresponds well to the early 90s neutral ENSO years mentioned before. The PNA hasn't had a sustained strong signal one way or the other this winter. The early 1990s and 2007, the PNA didn't have a strong signal either. And if you're a fan of the PDO, it's been neutral to slightly negative this winter. just as it was during much of the early 90s and 2007, though 1990 and 2007 were the best matches.
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious, and don't call me sure. So while I could exhaustively check every possible combinations of years like this, I'm taking the lazy route, and I'm saying these teleconnections don't necessarily disagree with my choice of analogs. And a casual sift through Brett's site, there's little useful correlation between a good storm chasing year and these teleconnections. Arctic Oscillation coming the closest to being an exception. Finally, using the NCAR database, I can mash up these signals together with my favorite cherry-picked analog winter years weighted together. Then I can make a custom map showing what we might be able to expect from April to June. And while these pretty psychedelic colors might not mean much to most people, what we're seeing here is a southeastern ridge and a western United States low pressure showing up as a frequent pattern in the mid-levels. Upper-level winds would be running right over the Rockies and through the plains more frequently than normal in this pattern. Now, I did say that these older analog years didn't quite match this pattern as well, and I may or may not have diagnosed exactly why or why not. So let's compare what I've done to the CFS anomalies for this spring.
What a pisser!
At first glance, these might look completely different. CFS seems to consistently run hot, and it's calibrated for a different climate period than NCAR. Still, there's some similarities. Well, at least for May. What about the southeastern U.S.? Well, that's an entirely different kind of chasing altogether.
It's an entirely different kind of chasing.
For the southeastern U.S., I'm expecting just a few events in February through April. Each of my analogs show a relatively quiet Dixie Alley, though I hinted at that last year and some of the Deep South overperformed. I don't make these forecasts entirely in a bubble. You can follow meteorologists like John that like to make similar tornado climatology guesses. A second year in a row, and I'm signaling hype for this year's storm chasing season. An active season on the high plains, west of I-35, through most of spring. And I'm also thinking things get off to an early start this year. That said, I thought that same thing would happen last year, and while it came close, it didn't quite verify. However, if a southeastern ridge gets established early or often, watch for the odd March or April major spring storm system with potential for tornadoes. For total number of tornadoes in the United States this year, I'm thinking under 1,200, or just below average. For storm chasing, this should lean toward a more quality year than a quantity one.
Would you like a little whiskey, man?
Certainly not.
Again, all of this is for fun. And while it's based on some established data and lines of thinking, a lot of this information is just my intuition and some pattern recognition. So take it for what it's worth.
Two things turned 40 this year, the movie Airplane and me. Thanks for watching, and let me know what you think down in the comments. If you want to see my sad reacts when this forecast fails miserably this spring, subscribe. And if I use one of your favorite jokes from Airplane, hit that like button. Here's to a fun and safe spring, and I'll see you out there.